And let me tell you a little story. So this is a garden shop that I go, went to pick up some beer and leave. I had my mask on, and one of the guys that I thought was a smart guy, and you know, that I'm cool with, he rolls to me and he says, how does the Kool-Aid taste?
How did New Zealand handle the coronavirus so much better than the US? What's their secret?
Simple. They got a woman leadership, you know, that my girl Jacinda, she does not play around, man. Like, she,
okay,
how it is when mama comes in and like, we're gonna shut it down and you're not gonna, nobody's gonna move. And you gotta look at it.
You know, all joke aside, you gotta start looking at all these countries that do have some woman leadership and how the coronavirus were handled compared to the United States, where we have, you know, this clown, this kid running. So it's like, we don't even know what they're doing. But if you look at places like New Zealand, Germany, and I believe was Iceland, I believe they has also have a woman leader. So I was, you know, you would look at them and you see like, what are they doing better that we're not doing?
Yeah, maybe they're not as hard-headed that they're able to listen to the experts.
Exactly. I've been to all three of those countries and I can tell you firsthand, they are a lot smarter than we are. And they're a lot more compassionate people than we are. They're a lot more caring. They're a lot more liberal than we are. So yeah, 100% is all about, I mean, I'm not trying to take away from the leaders, but it's definitely about the people doing the right thing over there too.
You know, and news that broke, a few days ago is that New Zealand, they lifted all the restrictions of coronavirus. They're able to walk around normal now.
Yep.
You know, everything's taken care of.
Yeah, because she doesn't play around. Like, you know, she is everything she does. I think if you look at it when, and not to get off topic, but when they had that the gunshot, you know, that thing, she went in and she banned all the gun sales, like, right away. There was no question asked, and we get moving. So when you have leaders like that that are putting people before profits, then we're definitely going to see things change relatively quick.
Well, let's try it for her. It's not like no questions asked, like she's going to be a dictator. You know, she had the people of her country wanted her to do this, and she did it. You know, so she had consent of the people.
It's just like super evident that, you know, this current administration has no interest in containing the coronavirus. Mm-hmm. We're now set month number 7 into this coronavirus, and we're still experiencing a large number of cases. Mm-hmm. And Trump continues to lead these events, these super spreader events. Like, at this point, I'm labeling it as a death cult because they're having events and they still have COVID, and you know, they're spreading it very widely. And it's clearly not in the interest of this administration, and probably those who are invested into this administration, the pharmaceutical companies, the medical industry, to have this pandemic contained and follow suit like the rest of the developed nations. We sit here today and, you know, there's 200,000 plus deaths in the United States, and the influence that the president has on the market, we're seeing it. It's substantial, right? Medical professionals are being led astray by a president that's touting misleading information time and time again. Yeah. And, you know, we talk about contact tracing and how impressive it is in New Zealand. And we compare it to how people here feel about just even wearing a mask, right? The right for so long has, you know, taken its talking points on the virus as, you're impeding on my civil liberties. Like, you telling me to wear a mask is impeding on my civil liberties. And the fact that we're having this type of discourse in this country is also a contributing factor to why we haven't been able to contain this virus, because we think about the virus in a way that is not intuitive in many ways.
Totally. Yeah, they don't stop to think that them not wearing a mask is impeding on my right to be alive. They could just literally kill me.
I was just going to say, it's because we're not educated. You look at those other countries, not only do they have great, way better education than we do, they also have, you know, national healthcare, which is freaking amazing and makes a huge difference here. Totally. But yeah, I mean, the bottom line is education. I mean, when your education system has failed, and then you're in the middle of a pandemic that's really dependent on science and facts and you know, not being stupid, we're going to fail that test every time.
Totally. I just want to bring up this article that is from The Guardian. America has a super spreader president. That's basically the title of it. And it just talks about how when Trump met with the Supreme Court justice that is going to be voted on, how he was huddled around the family. In one of the attorney general, William Barr, he wipes his snot from his nose and then onto his hand. And then he was shaking people's hands. You know, this was caught on camera. And then also When a team of doctors gave a rosy depiction of his condition to assemble news cameras on Saturday, saying his prognosis was good, his chief of staff promptly contradicted them in an attempt off-the-record conversation with pool reporters in which he said the president was doing much worse than the doctors had made it seem. So it's just a whole bunch of fog that the administration is throwing up there, and we really don't know exactly what's going on. And the last point I want to make is how much Trump does not care about people. So we know he doesn't care about his supporters, right? There's a lot of jobs that went overseas that he said he was going to make sure these manufacturing jobs do not go overseas. There's a whole bunch of different cases. You can see how he doesn't care about his supporters, but he doesn't care about his donors, his rich donors as well. He went to a New Jersey fundraiser. He didn't even let them know what was going on. He didn't put on a mask. He didn't make any special precautions, but he knew he was making $5 million from that fundraiser. So he wanted to get the money.
It's the whole OGP.
GOP. This event showed it, because even the press secretary, she went out knowing that Hope Hicks has shown symptoms. Yeah. I think she knew she was already tested positive at the time, and she was in contact with her. And she went out there, and now a couple of reporters at least have tested positive. So they care more about their appearance than actually doing the right thing. And that's one thing that New Zealand is doing the opposite of.
Yeah.
You know, and one example was an article that I read that they have such extensive contact tracing, that they figured out when somebody was tested positive, they figure out that they got it from another person that happened to touch the lid of a trash can. Mm-hmm. They narrowed it down to that level through contact tracing. In another example, they figured out that somebody caught a coronavirus from touching an elevator button. Meanwhile, this White House, this event, they refused to let the CDC come in and help with the contact tracing. They don't want anybody to know who got infected because they don't want to look bad or as a super spreader event.
Clear, the administration doesn't care about anybody not named Trump, you know, even down to the fact that Trump was getting in the limo, forcing Secret Service. Get in the limo, wave at his people. Mm-hmm. Second, he got to the White House. The first thing he did was take off his mask. I mean, it's clear that they don't care about anybody else except themselves, and it's capitalism over everything. They've rushed several times to reopen the economy so that they could kind of try to get a bump in the polls and say, hey, America's back, the economy's back, and every time they have to double back and show that we got a bunch of explosion cases. So let's go back on lockdown again. And okay, now we're going to rush the kids back to school, and then we're going to come back home. It's like there's no thought. It's always let's rush to get back. And then on the flip side, I at least I know here in Miami, as soon as they ease up anything, if they ease up 1 ounce and they say, hey, we're going to just allow a little more going out, everybody goes buck wild. They go out. They're in the restaurants with no masks. They're indoors having parties. Like, people just take the slightest bit of leeway, and they take it as coronavirus is done. And then in response, we see a spike. So we have to, people just have to use common sense and just realize that, you know, for the next foreseeable future, you know, we're probably going to have to be extra careful around people. Wear masks, disinfect your hands, like do like basic common sense things that, you know, we probably should be doing anyway. And I look at a lot of, I know how many of us years ago may have seen like Asian people on the airplane and don't have masks on. And I always felt like, wow, that's really like they're overdoing it. But, you know, other countries have dealt with pandemics before that we've kind of been relatively untouched in this lifetime and in these last couple decades. So when you see someone else of another culture wearing a mask, you know, they've lived through something that we haven't. And now we can see, oh, maybe they were right this whole time. You know, they're people being extra hygienic and things like that. That's what we need to do also. We need to think like maybe for the foreseeable future, when you get on an airplane, wear a mask. When you're in tight space, wear a mask and just be careful. So I think that's the best thing is just care about your fellow neighbor, because when you're wearing a mask, it's not for you. You're protecting everyone around you.
It only takes 6 to 8 weeks to contain this pandemic. If we put ourselves in our homes for 6 to 8 weeks, this would be over. And I think the United States government knew that. Right. And the leadership from the top down failed, unequivocally failed. And we're still here today with 200,000 plus deaths because of it.
Yeah, I think another reason for this is because they take profits over people. Because while all this thing was going on, they want to just open up the economy, open up everything. And meanwhile, they are giving businesses liability protection from the deaths of their employees. So, you know, they really don't care about the people. And like Joel said, it starts at the top. And we all heard the same, man. The fish rots from the head.
Totally. All right.
Yeah, you just got to look at those states, though. You got to look at the states like Florida and Georgia. You know, who are the governors? You know, like these people they just don't care. They just like, it's like, I think someone said, like, they just make decisions. It's like, okay, let's just see what happens. Let's open it back up. And if we get 100,000 cases, okay, we'll close that down. And if we don't, then we're good. Like, there's no like logic behind anything that they do.
And let me tell you a little story. You guys know how much I like craft brews and stuff. So this is garlic shop that I go often, or I used to go often. I stopped going. And one of the reasons is I went one time and I didn't want to stay there. I just went to pick up some beer and leave. I had my mask on. And one of the guys that I thought was a smart guy and, you know, that I'm cool with, he goes to me and he says, how does the Kool-Aid taste?
Wow.
I'm like, what you mean? What are we talking about? Oh, because you're drinking the Kool-Aid because of this hoax.
Oh, like, wow.
Like that? Just like that? Okay. So, you know, that man for me that I know what I was dealing with, the owner was letting people, you know, sit around and drink openly there. So I didn't feel comfortable going anymore. So I just stopped.
Yeah.
So the Kool-Aid tastes better than your beer.
I never seen any graffiti in my neighborhood. The other day, I just a spray painted under like an overpass, and it's like COVID is a hoax. It's like a neighborhood that you never see any kind of graffiti. For somebody to feel passionately enough to put that up is scary. And as far as a response, like I agree that the first part with what Joel said, you know, 6 to 8 weeks we could kill it, but it's like systemic racism. This is a systemic response to this. Once you kill it, you have to keep it killed. And that means that if people are leaving the country to go on vacation, they're going to have to come back and do mandatory quarantines of 20 days or something like that. Because otherwise you open up, you go, oh, great. It's dead. Everybody's going to go on vacation. They're going to come back and it's going to be all started again. So it's not just the eradication. It's also the maintenance. How do you keep us?
But it goes back to it, like if the leadership is not doing it, right? You got Trump coming 3 days, like, oh, whatever, don't believe in it. Then you have Lindsey Graham saying, oh, well, I don't need to be tested because my doctor said that I'm great. And, you know, so everybody that's coming in is telling these people like to do the opposite, right? Because our understanding is, oh, if you come in contact with someone, even if you don't have the virus, you should quarantine just so you could like take care of other people, right? And none of them are doing it. So when you're telling how are you going to expect people to do something when you're telling them to do the opposite?
Because they don't care about other people. Yeah. Established.
You saw Mike Lee, he didn't wear a mask today in the judicial hearing. Lindsey Graham, he refuses to take a COVID test so that the next debate, I think, is canceled as of right now, with even though he's getting his butt kicked anyway. So I'm sure he doesn't want to do that debate anyway.
Yeah, but he was on Fox News today crying about,
right? What he said, John?
Telling the donor to please help him and donate.
Yeah, we saw. Okay, and this is going into a different topic, but I'll say real quick that his opponent,
Jamie Harrison.
There we go. He raised the most amount of money in the third quarter. I believe it was over $50 million. So man, it looks like Gabe's challenge last week, $100, it worked.
Lindsey Graham's going to have to go again on Fox and go cry to get more
donations. Get more money. All right, if you got anything to say about the super spreader in chief, Trump, comment below. Let us know what you think. Like and subscribe.